My name is Gabriela Martinez. I'm the interim director for the Center for Latino, Latina, and Latin American Studies and associate professor of the School of Journalism and Communications. And I'm very happy to be here and to see so many people coming to this presentation. Before I move on to describe a little bit about the this presentation, I want to thank first the Schnitzer Museum for hosting the presentation here. And also I want to thank Cheryl Hartup, Associate Curator of Academic Programs in Latin American Art, because she has been also one of the forces for having this presentation here. And she's really very open to work with us, with class and all of the Latin American and Latino studies programs that we have on campus. So for those of you who are faculty, pay attention to when Cheryl is sending her calls out there, because we need more programmatic, a better programmatic agenda and more collaboration with the museum. So thank you, Cheryl, for your efforts with this. The presentation today is sponsored by the Center for Latino and Latin American Studies, and this is part of one of our research action projects, or RAPs, as we call them internally. This RAP is the Human Rights and Social Memory in Latin America, and today we have two of the members of this research action project, our colleagues Stephanie Wood and Carlos Aguirre. So without further ado, I'm going to leave the floor for Cheryl, who's going to do the introduction to my two dear colleagues here. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I was so pleased when Gabriela and Feather Crawford contacted me to hold this event here at the museum. Thank you so much for reaching out to us. We have a collection of over 500 works from Latin America, from pre-Hispanic times to the present, and we really welcome opportunities to collaborate with faculty and students engaged with Latino, Latina studies and Latin American studies. And the subject of today's presentation really resonates with works that we have on view in an exhibition that we just opened last Saturday. It's called Diálogos. It's upstairs in the Schnitzer Gallery. And it addresses military violence, oppression, systems of power in Latin America and the U.S.-Mexico border. So after Dr. Aguirre's and Dr. Wood's talk, I invite you to go upstairs and see the show. And now I'd like to introduce Professor Carlos Aguirre, who will give historical context for Presente, Art and the Disappeared in Latin America. Carlos Aguirre is professor of Latin American history here at the University of Oregon, and he obtained his MA at the Universidad Católica del Perú and his PhD at the University of Minnesota. He is the author of 5 books on the history of slavery, prisons, punishment, and intellectuals, and he has co-edited a number of books on those topics as well. His most recent monograph, published in 2015, reconstructed the early literary and political career of Peruvian writer Mario Vargas Llosa. He is currently working on a project that focuses on intellectuals and military nationalism in Peru between 1968 and 1975. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Carlos Aguirre.
Thank you. Thank you, Cheryl. Thank you, Gabby. Thank you all for being here. And I will be very brief, because this is Stephanie's show. She is the anchor of this project. I'm very happy to be part of it, but I will try to be as concise as I can. I'll say just a few remarks about the context of the project and some of the things that Stephanie will be talking about. We live in a period marked by a saturation of memory, as some scholars have called it. There is a memory boom palpable in the abundance of monographs and articles about memory and historical memory, the erection of monuments, the creation of memory sites, the writing of historical novels, the production of art and media connected to the past, museum exhibits, the formation of all kinds of historical archives, the proliferation of what has been called trauma tourism, and much more. This is particularly evident in the area of human rights. After periods of extended political violence, military repression, genocide, and human rights violations, multiple and contested efforts are being conducted to recover and preserve historical memory. These efforts are connected to the interest in reconstructing what happened, bringing perpetrators to court, seeking justice and reparation for victims, and shaping contemporary struggles, all with the hope that those atrocities will not be repeated. Some of these efforts emanate from post-conflict regimes in the form of truth commissions, for instance, but for the most part, they come from civil society, from victims, relatives, human rights organizations, artists, filmmakers, scholars, and ordinary citizens. The result of all this is what historian Steve Stern has called battles for memory. There is a contest about the past, about the facts and their interpretation, but also about who has the right, the authority, and the power to narrate it. A contest that, of course, is closely connected to political agendas in the present. Latin America, as most of you know, went through a period of massive human rights violations and political repression, especially during the Cold War, in countries such as Argentina, Chile, Guatemala, Peru, and others. Right-wing anti-communist regimes embarked on a systematic and brutal campaign to exterminate political, social, and labor organizations that were fighting for social change. Millions of peoples were displaced, killed, tortured, and disappeared during that period, leaving a legacy of trauma and suffering whose effects are still tangible today. The so-called post-conflict transition to democratic regimes was not necessarily accompanied by a serious, systematic, and transparent effort to elucidate what had happened and to bring to court those responsible for those atrocities. An effort to silence the voices demanding truth and to guarantee impunity to perpetrators accompanied those processes of transition. Still, civil society has not remained passive or indifferent. A massive, heterogeneous, and at times heroic effort is being conducted to overcome silence and impunity through a multiplicity of what Elizabeth Jelin has called vehicles of memory. That is, photography, art, songs, films, documentaries, oral testimonies, memory museums, monuments, archives, novels, murals, street naming, TV series, blogs, textbooks, graffiti, performances, street theater, and I could go on and on and on. These efforts are not only related to events of the past, however, since human rights violations, unfortunately, continue to mark the experience of Latin American peoples today. The disappearance of Ayotzinapa, the ongoing feminicide in Guatemala and the U.S.-Mexican border, the execution of environmental activists are just some of the most salient cases. Art, thus, is one of the many interventions in conversations about human rights and memory, past and present. Our project seeks to examine how artists have responded to human rights abuses in Latin America and along the U.S.-Mexico border during the second half of the 20th century and the early years of the 21st century. Artists are not only challenging the events of earlier decades, they are also confronting more recent injustices. Excuse me. As historian Cynthia Milton has written, in Latin America, one of the intended aims of art in response to atrocity seems to be this: to contest the barbarity committed and to restore the humanity of citizens who have been harmed. To that, I would add another goal, to make sure those stories are preserved. Art shapes individual and collective memories, but the reverse is also true. Memories shape art. Furthermore, as Milton also suggests, art may help not only those who have gone through traumatic events to put shape and meaning to their experiences, but art may also help those who have not directly experienced such events to come closer to a sympathetic awareness of them. In sum, art is a powerful instrument in the struggles for representation and memory, for the humanization of victims of human rights atrocities, and for the necessary education of citizens about the past, but also about the present. Stephanie's presentation will illustrate these issues by presenting one of the central elements of this project, which is Presente, which studies the depiction of the disappeared in Latin America in photographs, prints, posters, textiles, sculptures, and installations. Stephanie Wood is a historian of with multiple fields of expertise, from the history of indigenous peoples in Mesoamerica to digital humanities, art and human rights, the history of women in Latin America, and others. She's the author of Transcending Conquest, Nahua Views of Spanish Colonial Mexico, numerous articles, and the editor or co-editor of several volumes. She has presented her work literally around the world and directed for many years an NEH Summer Institute in Oaxaca. It's a real pleasure for me to work with her in this project and to introduce her to her presentation this afternoon. Thank you.
Good afternoon. It's just great to see this turnout. I feel a little sad that you had to come out from that beautiful sunny day into this closed space. I hope you'll find it interesting. I want to thank Cheryl and the museum and Carlos for the great introduction to this work in progress. I want to emphasize this is sort of a research report. We're still finishing up our project, and I'm just going to share where we are at this moment. We hope it will continue. I also want to go back and thank the CLAS, the Center for Latino and Latin American Studies, and the RAPS, the Research Action Projects. Without their support, I'm not sure we would be doing this today. It's really meant a lot, and I like the way they encourage collaborative research, because all too often we scholars sit in our lonely desks and don't have a lot of interactive and cross-fertilization like this. And Feather, thanks, and Paul for setting up the technology. So many people to thank. And as Carlos said, I'm here to discuss a digital collection, which we've been creating for more than a year now. It's part of my work in digital humanities. And the idea behind publishing art online is, for me, what I like to do is make it interactive. So I encourage you to visit our website, which I'll put the URL up in a minute. Maybe right now, at top there, because you can zoom in and see details and see the added commentary on those details, which I think gives you a deeper understanding of each piece. And what we'd like to do at some point is set up a space where you could comment as well and get that dialogue going. And as Carlos said, the focus of this body of work is late 20th and early 21st century Latin America. The concept of presente, which is something when you call roll at school, people might say presente, but it also means present. And the idea is to highlight works of art where the artist's purpose is to make the disappeared present, make them apparent to us. We currently have 14 pieces of art in the collection, but I've been visiting many museums across the Atlantic and here in the U.S. Looking for additional pieces. And so it takes time and resources and lots of support and willingness on the part of artists to share their works. And I just want to mention a couple of people who've been really crucial in helping create this site. And one of them is Ginny White, our database guru and server maintenance specialist. Ginny, are you here? Can you stand up and say? Stand up, take a bow. It's a dream working with her, and she's the brain of heart of this. I also want to recognize Professor Gabriela Martinez because she's a part of our research action project, and she's talking about making some mini documentaries about the artists and the works, which we would then attach to this website, so we're hoping to find funds to do that. And she's already interviewed the artist whose work is on our front splash page, if you will, of the website, Yeska, an artist who lives in Oaxaca. We've met with him and followed him over the years since 2006, and he's part of a larger group. You'll see one of their works upstairs if you please. I recommend attend the Diálogos show. Let's see. This is also on the splash page, which is sort of an introduction to our project, and then the types of works, the periods, and the countries thus far represented. And again, we hope to see this grow and become more complex and more interesting. We have a number of teachers already using this in high schools in Connecticut and California and elsewhere, and excited to, if any of you are teachers and would like to talk about this, I brought a couple of sample curricula that teachers have developed around this material. Here are the 14 works. If you ask to see the alphabetic list, you get a thumbnail and a brief bit of information, and then you click on that and you go and you can drill down. Okay, essential questions. I get this from working with teachers who develop curriculum in arguing that any lesson we're trying to extend or share, we should start with, you know, what are the really big questions, the really deep, important ones that we're dealing with. And so I thought I'd share with you a couple of those that I think might stir dialogue and discussion. And these are the kinds of humanities questions that right now are not very popular with government funders or with even donors. So I hope to see that change, because I think that how much more important can questions be such as, what is the purpose and meaning of life? And we in the humanities, we address these questions, and the answers are not easy, and the discussion is always very fruitful and enriching. Who are we? What is universal, and what is culturally or socially unique or specific about our identities? What connects or divides us, and with what result? And I think these questions really bear heavily not only on the project I'm sharing today, but on our lives in 2017 here in the United States. More specifically, entry questions can be somewhat more narrowly focused and grab the attention to help bring your audience into your specific presentation. So here, entry questions might include, can you imagine being considered an enemy of the state, an internal enemy in the United States, for instance, right now, in your life? Can you imagine being captured and disappeared, which usually meant in the end being killed, without due process of law? And if you saw this happening to others, if not to you, would you protest? And if so, how? Artists in Latin America found art to be a viable form of protest, of expression of concern, and yet artists were also targeted for disappearance too. And many of them, I'll be talking about today, lost relatives and close friends in the process of the disappearances. And so now their works are contributing to the memory projects that Carlos talked about. In constructing a sort of a framework for this project, I was especially impressed with the work of Mary Beth Tierney Tello, who has a book on photography and writing. But it really, a lot of what she has to say goes beyond simple photography, you know, to include many different kinds of art. And drawing from her work and others, I put together this list of goals, and Carlos has already alluded to some very similar goals. To denounce injustice, kidnapping, torture, murder, for example, to push back against impunity and amnesty for the state, to push back against erasure and oblivion of the disappeared, push back against apathy, particularly our own, to get us to question, to move us to action, to sensitize us and expand our consciences, to reflect on the society in which we live, how we disassociate ourselves all too often from these very horrific situations. These artists are seeking truth and accountability and reparation to heal wounds, open wounds The strange thing about disappearances is that it leaves so many questions and so many unknowns. There's a deep terror attached to it, which means an open wound that until there's information, never heals. To show solidarity with family and friends, this is something I see artists mentioning a lot. There is a great volume of posters about the disappearance of 43 students from a school called Ayotzinapa in Guerrero, Mexico in 2014. And one of the artists said, this work, these goals, it's always insufficient, but sincere. And I think that's really important to think, to remember. Another contributor to the theoretical framework for this project was Gustavo Germano, who came to the University of Oregon in 2015. And there is online on the UO channel a copy of the presentation he gave. It's in Spanish, but we had simultaneous translation. A few technical difficulties, so at the very beginning, bear with. But that's a program I recommend you take a look at if you're interested in this topic. Gustavo Germano wanted to give the disappeared visibility. and in his presentation, he discusses quite a bit about the theory around that idea and how to do it and why to denounce the disappearance. His brother was one of the disappeared. So as I said, many artists have had a very personal and close experience with disappearances. And here are a couple of examples of his work. Germano thought to make the disappeared present, he would exaggerate their absence. So it's a kind of a roundabout way to get there, but I think very effective. So he would take a contemporary photograph to pair with a historical photograph from the family that would show that there's somebody missing, someone's gone, someone's been disappeared. And so in this very personal example, he's in this photo with his brothers, and one of his brothers, as I said, was one of the disappeared, the one on the far right in the older photograph. But he also met with many different people, families who had disappeared loved ones, and would take an old photo and then pose a contemporary one with the person present. This type of approach continues in many different forms. Here's another example. This is a poster. In Chile, every year they have a competition for artists to represent human rights issues. And this one says, if you're missing, we're all missing. And there's a kind of a large blank canvas there where a portrait might have been, but the person's gone. So we're again being pointed out the absence of the individual. I like the way the message is in multiple colors. We'll find this is a common approach to use as if to suggest diversity. And also in the use of todas and todos in Spanish, you know, the gender, the more inclusive gendering of the term all of us. Another example from Chile is the dance that it was normally a couple's dance. And when it's performed alone, it's to bring out the awareness that that person's partner is gone. Empty chairs, this is another recurring trope. You'll find this in many different works. where are those people? And there are lots of them in this particular example. So many empty chairs. Magnitude is something else that artists try to address. And you'll see various examples of that. Some, the artists in particular in this case mentioned, trying to represent the invisible and also giving bodies to ghosts. Ghosts is another theme that recurs because it's very difficult to represent the disappeared if you don't have a photograph. Sometimes we do, as we'll see. In fact, empty desk, school desk in this case, again pointing to the Ayotzinapa, Mexico case, where 43 students who were studying to be teachers were disappeared. Their desks await them in this installation. You know, come back. We miss you. We want you back. They put their photographs, their ID photos, on each chair, too. So in this case, we know their names. We know their face. We have their faces. This is also from Ayotzinapa, another empty school desk. So again, you'll see that theme recurring. And leaving a candle burning is sort of another, I think, really global almost. A concept, we'll leave a light on for you, we'll leave a candle burning for you because we want you to come back, we're waiting. And the bottom text here was, their places await them, their places in the classroom. This is interesting because this poster was translated into Norwegian. It just shows how global this concern about human rights and what's happened to the students in Mexico has become. Candles, just another example, this one, or the number 43 was written in candles, so to speak, placed on the ground in front of the Santo Domingo Church in Oaxaca, Mexico. The numbers can become very symbolic. So in Mexico, almost anywhere you go, if you see graffiti has the number 43, you'll know now what it's about. It's a reference to these particular young men. And similar things in Guatemala, where we also work, Gabi and Carlos and I and others, Lynn and Aaron, we see the number 626. You know that that's reference to a number of massacres that have been documented. 30,000 is a number often seen in association with the dirty war in Argentina, and so on. 6 million in the Holocaust. So again, magnitude and symbolic numbers are recurring, making the present individual, but also humanizing those individuals, universalizing them. We see, in this example, what more personal and unique representation of us might be our fingerprints, if so unique. Here again, multiple colors, though, to emphasize uniqueness, but also collectivity and diversity. We're all different, we're all human, is the message of this example. Our eyes are also almost like fingerprints. In fact, nowadays there's technology that can read your iris and know if it's you or not. You know, if you're trying to get into a building, it's kind of shocking to think about. But this installation, which was in Rosario, Argentina, and Carlos photographed it for us, has multiple transparent plates with eyes, pairs of eyes looking at you, about eye height, but different heights. And here's a close-up, which for me is super haunting, to see, you know, the eyes of a disappeared person, and then the transparency where you look through the window and you see life going on as normal outside. You know, and where is this person? What's happened to her or to him? The other thing about this installation that really moves me is that when you look at that, your own reflection can be seen there too, and you can merge with and become identified with the disappeared, which is powerful. unique faces, so beyond our fingerprints and our eyes, you know, a unique face is very personal. And I wanted to discuss a little bit the concept of the ID photo, which is a very recurring theme in this, in many different kinds of art about the disappeared. This is a photograph of a protest of the mothers in Argentina during the dirty war, who went out asking, you know, where are our children, holding up their photos. Here's a protest in Chile that has the ID photo on a poster, on a stick. So it becomes to the point where now if you see someone, especially holding a black and white photo in a protest, you're gonna guess right away it's probably about the disappeared. Certainly it becomes very, very prevalent. And now in art, artists are taking those ID photos and sort of tweaking them or making them come alive, animating them, if you will. The use of the ID photo has a very long history, widespread and becoming symbolic, as I said. It's sort of ironic, Gustavo Germano has pointed out, that these ID photos were required by and created by the state. And now they're being taken and used by families and artists to protest the state, if you will, and the action, the state terrorism that led to the disappearance and often the murder of these people. And so the artists are adding color and doing other things to reanimate those faces. Mary Beth Tierney Tello calls this defiant memory work, which ties in with Steve Stern and some others who've looked at the same concept, which is not just remembering versus forgetting, but whose memories and whose meaning do these memories serve? And so the 43 from Ayotzinapa, because they were students and they all had IDs, their faces are everywhere in Mexico these days. This is an ID photo from Guatemala that's been colored by Brian Carlson, who painted right on a black and white image of this woman who has become very symbolic of the role of women, the participation of women in seeking social justice in the history of Guatemala, And in fact, you'll see lots of posters with her face. And one on the right has been repainted basically by an artist and made into another poster, saying that women in our struggle were lacking the rifle, very militant. She was a beauty queen, middle class, comfortable woman who came to see that the divide in Guatemala between the small elite of economic, political, and social power and status is so removed from the vast majority of people who have Maya heritage, and that this is fundamentally wrong. And she was questioning that. She was a girlfriend of a militant, and so she was disappeared and murdered. Barthes said every photograph is a certificate of presence, and so the use of these ID photos can be just a powerful statement in themselves. Nellie Richard has said the ID photo is a guardian of memory and an antidote to erasure. So keeping those faces in front of us has a political meaning. This is a school class picture that Marcelo Brodsky of Argentina took and started looking at many years after it was shot. And he, in the red circle there, Marcelo is sitting up very tall, and next to him is his best friend, Martin. Martin was disappeared during the Dirty War. And there are a few other students whose faces have been circled and crossed out who died. One fell in a battle, in a confrontation with state forces. Another died from a disease, an incurable disease, and so on. But he adds many other comments about what became of people. A great many went into exile because it was so dangerous. So many of their class and others around them in the late 60s and early 70s were suffering these kinds of fates. So I think this is a very powerful intervention, if you will, in a photograph. Brodsky's work has been called counter-hegemonic and having a great mnemonic potential for helping remember and to counter the master narrative. And again, to remember in order to learn in order not to repeat ever again. These are recurring phrases that artists often use as they describe their work. Okay, we've seen how the fingerprint and the faces, the eyes are all part of our personal and human identities. Here's an effort to put the body out there, to put the whole body out there and say, where are these people? This is the siluetazo, which was something that you could do by lying down on a big piece of paper and having somebody draw your outline and then maybe paint it and slap it up on a wall in town somewhere in the city, usually. Interesting thing about this group, it was started by a small group of artists, and then it had a contagion, if you will. I think other people were making them and doing the same. This is something, you know, you could just sneakily put up really fast and run, but it would question, where are these people? And there are sometimes, you know, aparición con vida, appearance alive, please, we want these people back alive, you know, slogans written on the bodies. The other thing is the middle and the right one, these are women, and something like 30% of the disappeared were female, and a number of them were pregnant, either when they were captured or after they were captured, they were impregnated by the guardians who were holding them. And then the children of the disappeared, the madres began saying, well, wait, not just where are our children, but where are our grandchildren, which has led to a number of films and writings and so on. And at least, I think there's an estimate, at least 500 grandchildren. And I think 119 or roughly around there, last I heard, were identified already using DNA methods, but there's something, you know, like 400 more, they're suspected, they're out there somewhere. And they were adopted by military families and owners of large corporations and so on who were close to the military. Another example, the siluetazo, and another pregnant woman. This is a work of a woman. I'm pretty in close touch with her daughter, who teaches at a university in California, and who is also a poet who reflects on the fate of the disappeared. But her mother is an artist and a poet, Raquel Partnoy, and this is one example of her work. It's not in Presente, but I'm hoping we'll get permission. But here's a couple who have just received a message about the fate of their son. And Raquel's son was disappeared and killed. And when they got that news, it was just like the worst message you could ever receive in your life and changes you forever. The daughter, who's still alive, was held for 5 months with her husband, but they were released, which was just like a stroke of luck, probably for them and for the whole family. But the purpose of this piece is to help us feel and think about what this does to families. And the ghost up above is kind of, again, as I mentioned, ghostly representations of the disappeared are fairly common, which I think is a reference to the horror, the kind of terror of uncertainty. Oh, we don't know what happened to them. Where are they? Are they alive? Are they dead? And this is a poem that Raquel, this artist that I just showed you, that she wrote, just to translate quickly to English. Where did life go? In the reappearances, in the words, in the smiles, in the truths that those who were disappeared cultivated. So it's kind of a dismal but then hopeful at the same time. And there are a lot of people who try to hang on to that concept. You know, yeah, they buried us, but they didn't know we were seeds. And new life and new interest and new struggle will come from our sacrifice. So this is very popular right now, especially in relation to Ayotzinapa and the 43 disappeared there. Okay, rethinking traditional monuments to the deceased. This is another common thread that runs through a large number of pieces. So we're accustomed to cemeteries. It's where we might go and visit our grandparents or parents who are buried. And it's really important to have a place to go, to mourn, to recall, remember our loved ones. Well, when you've been disappeared, your family doesn't have that opportunity most often. So artists are making sort of makeshift cemeteries. And this one really moved me because it's kind of, it's watery, it's floating, it's out at sea off the coast of Chile. The artist was the son of a sailmaker, so he's very familiar with the sea. Besides making this, he put 60 crosses that float and bob in the water as a memory of those whose bodies were thrown at sea, because we don't always know the exact locations. In fact, he makes artistic maps, kind of imaginary maps of where the bodies were probably thrown, but it's not really known. So that is another part of his body of work that's super interesting to me. But I think he made 60 of these crosses. And, you know, on a gray day like this photograph is just super powerful. A very similar thing happened in Colombia, also in the Rio de la Plata, where bodies were thrown in rivers. And here in Colombia, they've taken the ID photo and the parent holding the ID photo and writ these really large on huge, you can see the body on the right of this. This is the human person standing next to it on the raft. And they were floating these memorials down the river as a kind of, again, watery cemetery, if you will. They were called liquid tombs. They've been called a number of things. Imagine having two of your children disappeared. It's like one is bad enough, but two, horrific. And that wasn't all that uncommon. The use of pink in that last portrait is something that we also see happening more and more. The use of pink crosses, especially in association with the women who've been murdered and disappeared near the border, Ciudad Juarez, across from El Paso, Texas. The femicide that sees tens of thousands of women killed annually. Have often been represented in Mexico with these pink crosses, and it'll say "ni una más," not one more, and so on. Common slogans. And this artist in Oaxaca said, "Ni una menos," you know, let's not have one less, one fewer women. This is the problem. So we've seen crosses. Now, tombstones, of course, are other usual markers for the dead. And in this case, there was a very large wall. That in Chile that had the names of the disappeared or as many people as could be documented. And in 2004, this was, you know, this was put up, and I mean, this was taken down and broken, and said, "Oh, we're going to do something different." Well, artists saw all these broken pieces, and they thought, "Wait a minute, that's great material for, you know, a memorial to these people because of the broken lives and the broken nation that this represented in Chile, where roughly 3,500 people were documented to have been killed and or disappeared, and we don't know their fate." So. In a country where there were 35,000 probable human rights abuses, of especially torture, was very prominent in Chile. Anyway, this monument, which has the marble bits and the rebar holding them up in all different heights, and again, magnitude, lots and lots of pieces, I think that's really significant. On the website, you can zero in and have details magnified with attached commentary. So that's, I just show you an example there where some of the bits still have bits of the names or the dates in which they died, how old they were, 27, 30, so on. Young people, often male. Here again, speaking of tombs and these kinds of memorials, these are burial vaults, imagined burial vaults for the disappeared, made by a Colombian artist, which, again, because we don't have burial vaults for the disappeared, the artist's going to make them as a way to recognize and remember those people. And in this case, the town, the community where this was created, people in the community have been encouraged to adopt a tomb, baptize the person, i.e. give the person a name, take flowers, put a glass of water, bring something colorful. And so these tombs are all different colors. And so there's this amazing sort of human connection that has been sort of manufactured by the artist around this this battle with oblivion, if you will. So I think it's very, very beautiful, but also very sad. Putting names, naming, baptizing, naming the people, and putting their names on the vaults is a part of a larger phenomenon where a person's name is, again, something so personal and essential to their identity, who they are. And if we're going to remember them, we often want to call out the names. Say the name is another slogan you'll see a lot. And I remember at 9/11, a lot of us on the faculty stood up and read the names of the dead. In the Middle East, because you know we weren't the only country who was losing people at that time. So by remembering and naming and sort of doing a roll call of the dead, this is something that we find a lot. And it kind of goes along with the tombstone and the cross, because tombstone would have a name and dates and other family members a lot of times. A teacher that I worked with, Zach Foster, created a very large sort of banner that the parents of the disappeared of the Ayotzinapa 43 could carry in marches that has the names of the 43, sometimes the portraits as well, but the names writ large. And it's a very beautiful thing. This is a detail. It's a large banner, and he had friends hold it up, sometimes holding their babies as well. And it reminds me that quilts are things that we sometimes make to give to a couple when they've just had a new baby. It's something you wrap that baby in, you comfort that baby. And so this is that concept, taking a very loving textile and repurposing it in a very powerful way. And speaking of repurposing textiles, many of you may know of this. In Chilean history, there were women who went to the church oftentimes, to the church hall, to work on textiles, stitchery that they would make, and these were called arpilleras. And many of them are very specifically addressing the disappeared, but other human rights abuses as well. But the mothers often of the disappeared or their friends would sit together and create these appliqué pieces that ask, you know, where are the detained who have been disappeared. And here's another example. They're outside the church in this case, and the repressive forces are coming after them. They have very long dresses on, long sleeves, very much covered up, because women who went into the street were seen as street women, if you will, and that was not proper. But you know, if you're covered up and you're a mother, it's a little bit different, but still, the street wasn't a space where you were supposed to go. But these women could get away with these protests because it was traditional feminine art to stitch, to sew, and they were, you know, chastely dressed. Similar thing with the madres in Argentina. They were out in the street protesting, mothers protesting. It seems like an oxymoron. How could that be okay? And it wasn't exactly okay, but they got away with it probably more because they represented themselves, you know, as these respectful, you know, humble, chaste mothers, just asking, where are our children? That's our job as mothers to want to know that question. Of course, they suffered. They were called crazy. They were harassed. Their lawyers were disappeared, all kinds of terrible things. But they, and in community, having this community, doing it together, they stood up to power. Their scarves became a symbol in themselves of this position of denouncing the disappeared. Finally, last group, street art. I wanted to just show a few examples. This is a piece that's in Presente. It's a photographer, Christian Kirby, who actually took a photo of somebody else's work. These are, a great thing about street art is you can do it fast. You can prepare it ahead and then like, slap it up on the wall like the siluetazo. In this case, this is like a body that you might find thrown in the street to terrorize people. And someone has also plastered up pieces of paper that say, por qué, cuándo, dónde, and you know, all the questions that come with all the uncertainty of, you know, what's happened to this person and why and so on. The other thing about this piece is behind these papers that plastered there, there's a stencil of a bicycle. You can see down the bottom perimeter of the image. And we've kind of zoomed on that in the website. But this is a work by Francisco Traverso, who put the bicycle stencils all over Rosario and in a way to say, where's the writer? It's going back to this absence as presence idea. Like, this is a young boy who's gone missing, you know, who would normally be out there riding his bicycle. Not necessarily, you know, a teenager maybe, or even in his 20s. So that's a very heart-tugging piece. And this is Jeska's piece from our splash page, as I've shown a little bit before. This is the artist that Gabi and I have talked to on many occasions. This is a piece he donated to Presente, which addresses the Ayotzinapa disappearance, but also the massacre in 1968 in Mexico City in an ancient plaza, pre-Columbian part of the city called Tlatelolco, where something like 400 people were killed. We know very well now that this happened, but it's never been really fully documented. And so he's making an allusion between these two events, because in fact, the 43 young men who were disappeared from the Ayotzinapa school were about to commemorate October 2nd. They were disappeared at the end of September. And they were organizing a bus to get to Mexico City to participate in the annual march on October 2nd to recognize the massacre of Tlatelolco, because these are fellows, this was a student movement, a repression of a student movement in 68. So a lot of students, it's very big for them. It's very important. So it makes sense that Jeska would connect these two events in Mexican history. I wanted to show how he was drawing from historical photographs from 1968, where it was shown we have photos of young men being rounded up, pants pulled down to keep them from being able to run, shirts taken off, and things like that. And so he took three of those figures and sort of drew them and painted them, adding a lot of red paint to look like blood running down the wall and so on. And so that's an example of his street art. And then he, after he created it, he took a photo, so at least we still have it. So a lot of this is ephemeral. And you know, those some people get to see it, and then sometimes it's just gone forever. But fortunately, now more people are documenting street art. Okay, this is one last example where a historical photo has been taken and then intervened by the artist who was trying to represent the disappeared, like on superimposed. And there's a banner there that asks about not forgetting. And this piece is called Permanent Kidnapping, which is what disappearance is. And what he says about his piece is that the artist brings an energy of vengeance, taking graphics as a weapon for bringing a denunciation, fomenting dialogue, Remember diálogos upstairs? And in a crude and literal way, about the confusion and pain of the victims and their families. And I want to just end by with a quote from Ariel Dorfman, that silence will never have the last word. I think that sums up pretty well what these artists feel. Thank you.
So we have a few minutes for questions, and then at the end, I will give a couple of announcements.
And Carlos.
Well, I do want to thank everyone that's been involved with this project, especially Stephanie. That looks amazing. I look forward to taking a look at it. I wanted to talk about the title, Presente. You mentioned it was something that students can say in response to roll call, and that it means that people are present with us. I assumed it was also invoking a more political use of presente that is used throughout throughout the Spanish-speaking world in sort of funeral situations, but then becomes much more political as human rights activists call out the names of the disappeared and the murdered, and
you're
respond
right
with presente.
Definitely.
Okay.
Definitely. Yeah, like you can yell out Che Guevara and people will yell, presente.
Yeah. Yeah. Carlos, come on.
Presente. Questions for me?
I'm going to make him present here. Now. Any questions?
One of the things I noticed is that because they're disappeared, like they're probably young or beautiful or alive, did you encounter any photographs or did you choose not to include photographs which were evident violence against the body or you saw the body and the corpses? How did you encounter that?
Yeah, actually there are pieces that show a lot of disfigurement and blood and terrible evidence of violence, yes. I have mixed feelings about some of those. I want to maintain a seriousness and a respect and not go too much so sensational, toward the sensational. And yet it's a fine line, isn't it? I mean, because it's all disturbing. It's very disturbing. And there are people who say, you know, this, they question this whole focus, you know, it, as something that's too politicized or too, since maybe taking advantage of the disappeared and making money off of it by making art and selling it. I say a lot of these people are not making money, just to say that. I mean, again, that's something I would maybe choose in making the collection is those who are making, you know, $15,000 off of a piece. Maybe that's exploitation. I don't know. Carlos, do you have anything you want to say?
Well, I just want to mention an example of a very powerful way of making the same message without using this more grotesque, you know, photos, pictures, whatever. In Rosario, in the museum that Stephanie showed one of the pictures from, there's an area that has two walls. In both are puzzles, right? And in one side, and each piece of the puzzle has the face of, you know, a disappeared. And in one of the walls, it's an incomplete puzzle, right? With the pictures of those that have been identified, right? And on the other side, those that have not yet been identified, right? So anytime, you know, these groups work in Argentina, identify one, they just move here. And you can tell, right, that you have a, you know, big wall and there are missing pieces. It's very sober, you know, it's and but it's very powerful. And so I think, I mean, I don't want to suggest that this is the only way of doing this, right? But there are ways in which you can convey a powerful message about this horrible facts without using some of the most, how can I say, evident ways in which they were killed or tortured or things like that.
So. I'm curious about the differences between what is presented in museums appeared in Latin America vis-a-vis the work that's in the archive, the digital archive? Are there differences? Are they two completely different kind of contexts for the work, or are there some differences?
Well, yeah, it's complicated because, say, your traditional art gallery where they're selling work in a city would have maybe nothing like this. Maybe they would. It depends on the tourism. You know, there's trauma tourism. But also then there are institutions that are run by the state. And so, and they're setting up museums and, you know, showing some of this kind of art. But maybe there, the institutional selection is probably something one could study and look at. Then the street art, which was very clandestine and yet public at the same time, but and anonymous usually. Some of that's now actually ending up in galleries and museums. And some of those people are being paid to travel around the world. And the lines are kind of blurry between the difference, but it would be an interesting research project, I think. Yeah.
One quick thing is that there are, of course, now many museums and galleries specifically devoted to these topics, right? I mean, that has become very common. And another thing is that, although they are not that numerous, but there are pieces produced by the victims themselves, which is another, you know, completely, you know, different set of pieces. I mean, political prisoners, for instance, that produce art and then somehow survived. You can see some of those in galleries, not private commercial galleries, but in sort of memory sites and museums, right? For instance, in the former detention center in Buenos Aires, the ESMA, right? Show pieces that were saved from women that were eventually disappeared, right? And they, you know, they I remember a handkerchief. I don't know if I remember that. Mm-hmm. It was one of the most moving moments. It was a handkerchief that she, how do you say, bordeaux?
Embroidered
mm-hmm. with the lyrics of a song written by Joan Manuel Serrat, the Catalan musician, and the title is De Parto. It's a beautiful song that celebrates the pregnancy. And this woman was pregnant, detained. And so she embroidered the lyrics of the song in this handkerchief, and then she was killed. And then a friend of hers that was also detained and survived kept it, and then gave it to the song was born, right, before she was killed, survived, and then he donated it to the museum. So, I mean, it's to a certain extent, it's art, right, but it's also evidence of what happened, right, and that makes it twice as powerful, I think.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I'm struck because of just more of an observation, but also some, I guess, two questions. We recently had Steve Friedson come and talk about the use of music in torture. So we have this situation where sound and particularly music, which is often celebrated as a healing kind of space, is applied in a very targeted way and actually silences a relief rather than... than sort of a different way of thinking about that space. And it strikes me just watching this that, you know, in those torture spaces that it's sensory deprivation that is applied visually. So you don't see, you don't hear, you don't see, but music is pummeled into your ears. And it leads me to two questions. One about the use of sound and the possible use of multimedia on the archival site here. And in the museums, I know that there must be some use of sound depending on what the installation might be. And secondly, about, and I, you know, the first thing that I think of is by use of the people who are perpetrating the disappearances and the torture, that first is sensory deprivation, there's also the use of visuals for propaganda, and I'm wondering if there's any kind of mention or trope that involves I guess other than perhaps just the display of violence, that would be something that would sort of counteract the healing trope of visual art in this particular case. Mm.
I like the idea of adding multimedia. We thought about videos, but I think some soundtracks would also be super interesting. In the stadium in Chile, Victor Jara, who was a guitar singer and a guitar player, you know, he was killed, but he was playing. Some of his music might be interesting. I mean, there's so many pieces relating to the disappeared. There's Sting did a song about the Cueca Sola. But yeah, also from the other side, the horrific noises that people were subjected to as part of their torture, I think that would be really powerful maybe. So thank you for that suggestion.
Well, there is also the most sort of grotesque use of music during torture sessions, right? And in some cases, beautiful music, right? That, of course, for those that survived, you know, they could never actually listen to that music again because of the memories that they will bring back. So yes, I mean, I'm not an expert on these, but I've seen in different memory human rights museums videos that are played over and over again, right, with images, sounds, music, right, and it's very powerful. It's more dynamic than just, you know, a still photo, right, and it brings back some of the climate, right, the climate that these people lived through in those times, right, black and white. Videos, these kinds of things are also very powerful.
Any other questions?
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you for coming.